Dr. Anthony Garcia, a former medical resident, committed a series of revenge-driven murders after being dismissed from his residency program at Creighton University in Omaha, Nebraska, in 2001. The murders were seen as acts of revenge against those he blamed for his career troubles following his dismissal from the residency program. In 2013, Garcia was arrested and later convicted of 4 counts of first-degree murder in 2016. On Thursday, March 13, 2008, Thomas Hunter, a 6th-grade student, got off the school bus and rushed home to play video games. Tom was an avid gamer, and most of his friends were online friends he had never met in person but gamed with online daily. His parents, both physicians at Creighton University Medical Center in Omaha, were not home. His father was at work, and his mother was out of town on a business trip. The weekly housekeeper, Shirley Sherman, was present in the home when Tom arrived. When Dr. William Hunter returned home hours later, he found a ghastly sight. Dr. Hunter made a 911 call that shocked the entire Dundee community of Omaha, Nebraska. He found his 11-year-old son and the housekeeper dead in the house. They had both been brutally murdered. When Dr. Hunter arrived home at 6 that evening, he saw Shirley's car still parked in front of the house. He assumed she was just running behind. When he entered the house, however, he found her body in the hallway with a knife sticking out of the flesh. As a pathologist, the head of the pathology residency program, Dr. Hunter, was familiar with death and assessing dead bodies. However, nothing could prepare him to find his young son stabbed to death in the dining room with a knife from his kitchen protruding from the boy's neck. Thomas Hunter was the youngest of 4 boys born to Dr. William Hunter, a pathologist, and Dr. Claire Hunter, a cardiologist. Both worked at Creighton University Medical Center. Dr. William Hunter was the head of the pathology residency program at the teaching hospital. Their other 3 sons were all grown, with the next youngest away at college in 2008. Tom was a 6th grade student at a magnet school specializing in math and science. The boy had a bright future ahead of him, but that was tragically stolen from him on March 13, 2008. Shirley Sherman was 57 years old and had spent her entire life in Omaha. She had 2 children that she loved dearly and worked hard to provide for them as a single mother. As she got older, she started working less to accommodate time with her 5 precious grandchildren. She continued to work as a housekeeper part-time for select clients, however, including the Hunter family. She loved gardening and crafts and was described as having an infectious laugh. Her death was a tremendous loss for all those who knew her. Police did not find any solid evidence in the home. The knives used to kill Tom and Shirley were from the Hunter's home. There was no forensic evidence such as fingerprints, DNA, or fibers found at the scene. There was nothing of value missing from the home, leading authorities to believe robbery was not the motive. Police did, however, have a description of a possible person of interest who was seen in the area on the day of the murders. He was described as a heavyset olive-skinned man who drove a Honda CR-V with out-of-state plates. Detectives wondered if Tom Hunter had met someone online while video gaming who may have been a predator. They investigated every contact Tom made while playing his Xbox, but every contact was alibied and nothing suspicious was found. They then looked at Shirley Sherman's personal life, thinking she may have been the target. The only thing that could be discovered was a tumultuous relationship with Shirley's daughter's boyfriend. However, the boyfriend was quickly ruled out as a suspect due to a rock-solid alibi. The only other thought detectives had was perhaps Dr. Bill Hunter or his wife had been the intended targets of the crime. Detectives discovered that sometimes physicians were terminated from the Creighton University Medical Center Pathology Residency Program under the direction and authority of Dr. Bill Hunter. One physician had been very vocal about his termination from the program. Police questioned the doctor, and while he confirmed his frustration and perceived mistreatment by the hospital, he adamantly denied any involvement in the murders. He was over 900 miles away at the time of the crime, working in another hospital. With no other leads, the double murder case in this affluent neighborhood grew cold. 5 years went by without any progress in the murder case. Then, on May 14th, 2013, police were called by a piano mover. He had shown up at a residence to move a piano as ordered, but the residents of the home were not answering the door. He noticed that the front door was slightly open with a gun magazine lying in the doorway. Finding this oddly suspicious, the man called authorities to do a welfare check on the couple that lived here, Dr. Roger Brumback and his wife Mary. Inside, police found Roger and Mary Brumback deceased from multiple stab wounds and knives protruding from their flesh in much the same way as the 2008 homicide victims. Dr. Roger Brumback was born in 1948 in Washington, D.C. After completing his undergraduate studies in less than 2 years, Roger became the youngest member of the inaugural class at Pennsylvania State University College of Medicine in Hershey. He was a pediatric resident later at Johns Hopkins University Hospital and then at Barnes Jewish Hospital and Children's Hospital in St. Louis, Missouri. Dr. Brumback had a long medical career, including working in neurology, stroke prevention, Alzheimer's disease research, and co-authoring at least 19 books and 130 medical journal articles. In 2001, he was named the professor chair of the Department of Pathology at Creighton University Medical Center in Omaha. Mary Brumback was outstanding in her own right. She was born in 1947 in Washington State. She met her husband in college while studying pharmacology. She was a pharmacist and mother to her and Roger's children. She was involved in her community through philanthropic activities and had co-authored multiple books with her husband. She enjoyed cooking and baking and prided herself in using healthy ingredients. Additionally, she enjoyed gardening and genealogy research. Police learned that on the day that the couple was murdered, another physician from the Creighton University Medical Center's pathology residency program had an attempted break-in at her home just an hour or so before the murder occurred at the Brumbacks' home. Unfortunately, she wasn't home at the time and her alarm seemed to scare the perpetrator off. A small amount of DNA was taken from the door for comparison to suspects. Police linked the crimes together and determined that the motive was revenge on the physicians leading to pathology residency program. Detectives did a deep dive into the records at Creighton University. One file in particular stood out to officials. A doctor named Anthony Garcia had been terminated from the program in 2001 due to unprofessional conduct. The physician whose home was nearly broken into on the day Mr. and Mrs. Brumback died had described Dr. Anthony Garcia as rude, lazy, adversarial, disruptive, arrogant, combative, mean-spirited. The physician had complained to Dr. Bill Hunter about Garcia's lack of knowledge and poor attitude several times, recommending he be removed from the program. It was another incident, however, that eventually led to Dr. Anthony Garcia being terminated from Creighton. In 2001, Dr. Garcia was a resident in the pathology department and assisted in an autopsy on a larger woman weighing over 350 pounds. After the autopsy, Garcia was left in charge of returning the body to the morgue. He turned the body over to get the remains back on the stretcher, but left the woman's body face down on the stretcher. When the body arrived at the funeral home, blood had pulled on her face, causing disfigurement. The family was very upset, and the funeral home reported the incident to Dr. William Hunter and Dr. Roger Brumback. Dr. Anthony Garcia was terminated from Creighton after the incident. Following his termination from Creighton, Anthony Garcia was terminated from several other residency programs and barred from practicing in some states. He was terminated in 2004 from the University of Illinois, Chicago, after frequent long-term absences and failure to communicate with his supervisors, but he remained licensed in Illinois. He had also been terminated from a program in New York in just weeks before the 2008 murders. He was fired from LSU Shreveport for lying on his application about being fired from Creighton. It seemed no matter where Garcia went, his problems at Creighton followed him. Under investigation, it was determined that phone records placed Dr. Garcia in Omaha at the time of the Brumback murders. A restaurant receipt put him a mile from the physician's home an hour before the crime and just a few minutes after the attempted break-in, in which was just down the street from the restaurant. His phone search history showed that he had searched for the Brumback address just before the murders. It is believed that he went to the first doctor's home, but when he realized she was not home, he went to get lunch and looked up the Brumback address. He then went to the Brumback home and murdered Dr. Roger and Mary Brumback. The investigation showed that Dr. Garcia was spending large amounts of money on alcohol and at gentlemen's clubs. He couldn't seem to keep a job despite graduating from medical school in 1999. His home in Terre Haute, Indiana was largely empty and under foreclosure. It seemed Dr. Garcia had hit rock bottom. He was on the run when police showed up in Indiana to arrest him, with his phone pinging in southern Illinois. At this point, detectives knew that DNA from the attempted break-in was a match to Dr. Anthony Garcia. Police were tracking Anthony Garcia's phone and finally, he was arrested in Jonesboro, Illinois in July of 2013. Upon his arrest, he had a blood alcohol level well above the legal limit and was drunk. He was arrested for DUI and extradited to Nebraska to face murder charges. He was charged with 4 counts of first-degree murder and was facing the death penalty. There were 3 years between Anthony Garcia's arrest and the beginning of his murder trial. During that time, Anthony Garcia was confined and seemed to decline mentally. For one thing, he lost a significant amount of weight. Second, his attorneys claimed that his mental status was compromised and requested that a competency evaluation be done. He stopped talking to his attorneys but was determined to be fit to stand trial. The trial began in 2016. The evidence against Anthony Garcia included the DNA that was matched to him from the attempted break-in as well as his grievances with the doctors at Creighton. His phone record showed he was in Omaha at the time of the murders. His search history showed he looked up the Brumback address and for quotes on revenge. Prominently displayed in his home was the termination letter from Creighton signed by Dr. Brumback and Dr. Hunter, as well as a list of reminders such as park down the road, use tape on your fingers, buy common shoes, and other items that seemed to be a killer's to-do list. The murders followed terminations from other programs, some related to his misconduct at Creighton. A confound near Anthony Garcia's Indiana home was missing the magazine and determined to be a match to the magazine found at the Brumback house. It was registered to Dr. Anthony Garcia. Dr. Garcia also matched the description given by neighbors in 2008 when Tom Hunter and Shirley Sherman were murdered. He was overweight with olive-colored skin and drove a silver Honda CR-V with Louisiana plates in 2008. Finally, a stripper came forward and testified that Dr. Garcia once told her he had murdered an old woman and young boy. When she informed him that she only dated bad boys, the evidence didn't look good for Dr. Garcia. Dr. Garcia spent the majority of the trial sleeping and looking non-interested in the proceedings. This caused an uphill battle for his attorneys, led by Robert Montes Sr. and Robert Montes Jr. Robert Montes Sr. once defended infamous serial killer John Wayne Casey. The attorneys pointed out the circumstantial evidence as just that and argued there was no rock-solid evidence to connect their client to the murders. They claimed the digital forensics were improperly handled and may have been tampered with. Despite their best efforts, the defense team failed to poke enough holes in the prosecution's case. Dr. Anthony Garcia was found guilty on all counts in October 2016. Due to concerns about Anthony Garcia's mental fitness, sentencing was delayed following hearings again to determine if he was mentally fit. In September of 2018, the sentencing was finally ready to happen. Before the sentence could be handed down, the lead judge suffered a medical emergency and was taken out of the courtroom by ambulance. Another judge replaced him, and Anthony Garcia entered the courtroom via a wheelchair. He had gained back weight and appeared to sleep through his sentencing hearing just as he had his trial. He was sentenced to the death penalty for his crimes. Following his conviction, Garcia has been held in solitary confinement for 23 hours a day. His mental state has been a subject of concern, with his attorneys arguing that the prolonged isolation has impacted his mental health. Despite this, Garcia has shown little remorse and remains largely uncommunicative. In 2008, Sarah Widmer was found drowned in her bathtub in Warren County, Ohio. Her husband, Ryan Widmer, was convicted of her murder after 3 trials, with the key evidence being her lack of injuries consistent with a slip and fall. Ryan Widmer maintains his innocence, and the case has been controversial, with debates over forensic evidence and trial conduct. On August 11, 2008, Sarah Widmer, a 24-year-old dental hygienist, and her 27-year-old husband Ryan Widmer, a sports planner, were at their home in Fort Thomas, Kentucky. Sarah had just finished her shift at a dental office, and Ryan had finished his day as well. The couple, who met through mutual friends and quickly became inseparable, spent a quiet evening together. Their relationship had progressed from a blind date at a pub to purchasing a home, marrying, and being in the midst of newlywed bliss after only 4 months of marriage, as they looked forward to their future, which included plans for a Costa Rica honeymoon and a Cancun vacation. On August 11th, Ryan and Sarah Widmer watched TV while eating leftover hamburgers, corn on the cob, and cheesy potatoes. According to Ryan, they began with some of Sarah's favorite shows before moving on to a football game. Sarah then decided to take a bath in the master bedroom bathroom. Ryan recalled that she asked him to check the doors before accompanying her upstairs. That night, Ryan dialed 911. The call lasted 7 minutes. He told the 911 dispatcher that his wife had fallen asleep in the bathtub at their home in Morrow, Ohio. He told the dispatcher that he had been watching TV downstairs and went upstairs to find Sarah lying face down in the bathtub. He mentioned that she frequently fell asleep in the bathtub. Ryan followed the dispatcher's instructions and removed Sarah from the bathtub before being guided through CPR. During this time, he temporarily put the phone down to empty the tub and lift Sarah, which took approximately 29 seconds. Within 6 minutes of receiving the 911 call, police found Sarah naked on the bedroom floor. Her body felt warm and dry, but her hair was wet. While performing CPR, the police noticed a pinkish-white, frothy discharge coming from Sarah's mouth and nose, indicating drowning. When paramedics arrived, they made 2 unsuccessful attempts to intubate Sarah in her bedroom. 2 more attempts were made in the ambulance during the 10-minute ride to the hospital. Despite a 5th unsuccessful intubation attempt, the hospital's emergency room physician made a 6th attempt and was successful. Unfortunately, it was too late. Sarah was pronounced dead the same night. When questioned at the hospital, Ryan told police that he and Sarah were alone at home that night. He mentioned watching a football game on the downstairs TV while Sarah was taking a bath around 10 p.m., and he expressed concern to the police that he was afraid she would fall asleep in the bathtub. When asked if Sarah had fallen asleep in the bathtub, Ryan said no, but she did have a habit of falling asleep in unusual places. Despite Ryan's claim to the police that he found Sarah in the bathtub and assumed she had fallen asleep, authorities became suspicious. When they arrived at the house, they noticed Sarah's skin was dry, but her hair was wet. Detectives noticed inconsistencies in Ryan's account, particularly during the 911 call when he described finding Sarah lying face down in the tub. There were concerns about a potential contradiction because they believed Ryan told the nurse at the hospital that he found her lying face up. During the search of the large Mirror residence, law enforcement discovered several discrepancies that raised further concerns. The bathroom floor, bathroom mat, and towel on the floor were all dry. The bathtub was mostly dry, with only a few droplets visible near the drain. Notably, no wet towels were found in the home. Police discovered additional inconsistencies in Ryan's narrative. Ryan had initially told them that he was watching a Cincinnati Bengals football game on the television downstairs while Sarah took a bath. However, upon inspection, the downstairs TV was not tuned to that channel. Instead, the bedroom television was set to the specified channel. Police also discovered bloodstains on the bedroom carpet where Sarah had been found lying on the floor when they arrived. These findings raised suspicions and added to the growing list of inconsistencies in Ryan's account of what happened that night. Dr. Russell Updegrovi, the Warren County coroner, performed the autopsy on Sarah and his findings revealed that her cause of death was drowning. Notably, several physical injuries were documented during the examination, including faint bruising on the right side of her forehead, a specific hemorrhage on the inner surface of her eyelid, bruising on the left side of her neck, a contusion on the back of her neck, and bruising and lacerations on her upper lip. Sarah had deep muscle hemorrhaging in the front of her neck, as well as scalp contusions. Dr. Upadrovi determined that Sarah's death was the result of a homicide. He stated that Sarah's injury occurred prior to her death and was not consistent with injuries commonly associated with PPR. Toxicology reports confirmed the absence of prohibited substances and alcohol in the system. Ryan was arrested for aggravated murder on August 13, 2008, just 2 days after Sarah died. It was the prosecution's case that Sarah died as a result of drowning. Their argument was that the cause of Sarah's death was less important than how she died. The prosecution claimed that the 911 call, the crime scene, and Sarah's injuries all pointed to Ryan as the perpetrator of her death. Their argument revolved around the claim that he had forcibly held her underwater, causing her to drown in the bathtub. During the investigation, the police dusted the bathtub for fingerprints and discovered streak marks believed to be caused by human hands, primarily in the center of the tub. They used a superglue fuming process and reflected ultraviolet imaging to detect finger and smear marks. A forearm impression was also discovered on the bathtub, which was determined to be made by an adult male using hair follicle testing. However, the exact timing of the impression could not be determined. The prosecution also claimed that the lack of wetness inside the bathroom was incompatible with the scenario Ryan described. If Sarah had drowned and Ryan had pulled her out of the bathtub, the floor and other bathroom items would have been soaked. They emphasized to the jury that Sarah's body was dry when police arrived minutes after Ryan called 911. The prosecution cited details from the 911 call, claiming that Ryan had revealed too much information and was orchestrating the call, implying premeditation. The prosecution told the jury that a violent confrontation took place in the Widmer home that fateful night. Although the reasons for it were unknown, they brought in an expert witness who testified that it was extremely unlikely to fall asleep and drown in a bathtub without the use of prohibited substances or alcohol. According to this testimony, the sensation of water on the face or the activation of the gag reflex would usually wake up an individual, and if that didn't work, a drop in oxygen levels would do the trick. The prosecution called on Coroner Upadrovi, who performed Sarah's autopsy, to provide his expert opinion on the events of that night. He testified that a plausible explanation for Sarah's dried body and wet hair would be that her head was pushed over the edge of a bathtub, toilet, or sink. This act could have occurred either forwards or backwards in running water, or submerged in full water. The prosecution's central claim was that Ryan purposefully held Sarah's head underwater until she drowned, and they argued that he should be found guilty of her murder. In response, the defense argued that there was insufficient evidence to back up Ryan's claim of killing Sarah. They emphasized the couple's apparent love and argued that Ryan had no discernible motive to harm Sarah. According to the defense, those who knew Ryan had never seen him angry or raising his voice. Friends of the couple attested to their happiness and shared the belief that they were planning a bright future together. To bolster their case, the defense performed their own autopsy, presumably to challenge or provide an alternative viewpoint to the findings presented by the prosecution's witnesses, particularly Coroner Upadrovi. Dr. Werner Spitz, who had been retained by the defense, conducted a second autopsy on August 15, 2008, 2 days after the first, although he agreed with the conclusion that Sarah's cause of death was drowning. Spitz expressed a different opinion on the manner of death, saying he would have ruled it undetermined. He saw several injuries on her neck, arms near the crease of her elbow, upper lip, nape of her neck scalp, a tear in her liver, and neck hemorrhaging. Dr. Spitz was unable to definitively determine whether these injuries were the result of CPR. As a result, he stated that he would not consider her death a homicide. The defense contended that if there had been a violent altercation, as the prosecution claimed, there would have been evidence of it. Notably, Ryan and Sarah's nails were found to be unbroken or chipped without any injuries. The defense also brought attention to the presence of female DNA found under Sarah's fingernails, with no match identified. They contended that Sarah's injuries were most likely the result of the extended CPR and multiple intubation attempts performed that night, both inside the house and in the ambulance parked outside the house during transportation to the hospital. and in the hospital itself, the defense posited the theory that something medical, such as a seizure or cardiac ailment, could have been the underlying cause of Sarah's death. They also explained the seemingly contradictory evidence of Sarah's dried body and wet hair, claiming that skin dries more quickly than hair. In the first trial, the jury found Ryan not guilty of aggravated murder, but convicted him of murder. A few months later, however, a new trial was ordered in response to the defense's concerns. It was discovered that some jurors had conducted their own tests on how long it took them to dry after taking a bath, potentially influencing their interpretation of the evidence. Ryan's second trial was in May 2010. However, the jury was unable to reach a decision, prompting the declaration of a mistrial. Ryan's third trial began in January 2011, with additional evidence being introduced into the legal proceedings. The defense sought to establish a case that Sarah had an undisclosed cardiovascular or neurological condition that caused her to lose consciousness and drown in the bathtub. To back up this claim, they presented testimony from several medical experts who suggested the possibility of such an underlying medical issue. However, the state countered these claims by bringing in their own medical experts to challenge and refute the defense's assertions. Sarah's co-workers' testimony revealed more about her health and daily routine. They described Sarah sleeping in her car before starting work in the mornings and going out to rest during her lunch breaks. Colleagues also revealed that she suffered from allergies and had headaches and stomach pains. On at least one occasion, her headaches were severe enough to cause blurred vision, forcing her to retreat to a dark room until the symptoms passed. Dr. Benjamin Messmer, a dentist at Sarah's practice, took the stand and testified that he was present when she died. He recalled her complaining of a headache and stomach ache that day. Sarah's friend's testimony painted a picture of her tendency to fall asleep in unexpected places, such as during a game or in the middle of group discussions. One of her friends suspected she had narcolepsy, a sleep disorder characterized by excessive sleepiness, sleep paralysis, hallucinations, and in some cases, cataplexy. In contrast, Sarah's mother, Ruth, and Stewart testified for the prosecution. She stated that she had never noticed anything unusual about her daughter's sleeping habits. Sarah, however, did experience headaches. Ruth believed they were the result of sinus problems. According to Ruth's testimony, she spoke with Sarah on the day she died as she was leaving work, and Sarah made no mention of having a headache. Ruth stated that there was no family history of seizures, heart disease, or cardiac problems. Sarah had a heart murmur and a cleft palate as a baby, but a physical examination report from June 2008 made no mention of the heart murmur's continued presence. Furthermore, there was no mention of a cardiac condition, neurological defect, or disease in the report. Jennifer Cruz's testimony provided an important and potentially damaging account. According to her statements, she contacted Ryan while he was in prison after seeing a Dateline episode about his case. She claimed that on October 26, 2009, Ryan called her and confessed to Sarah's murder. Jennifer testified that Ryan stated, "I did it. I killed Sarah." Furthermore, Jennifer claimed that during the 911 call, Ryan only pretended to perform CPR because he knew Sarah was already dead, rendering resuscitation futile. Despite this shocking revelation, Jennifer continued to communicate with Ryan following their initial discussion. Ryan did not report the incriminating conversation to the police until after her second trial was declared a mistrial. In response to Jennifer's testimony, the defense attempted to undermine her credibility. They presented evidence of her previous prescription drug addiction and misdemeanor theft convictions, attempting to cast doubt on the veracity of her statements and motivations. The defense presented a challenging scenario, claiming that they could not definitively explain what caused Sarah to drown that night. The defense urged the jury to consider all of the facts in the case, emphasizing that Ryan had no apparent motive to harm Sarah. Despite these arguments, Ryan was ultimately convicted of murder and sentenced to 15 to life in prison. Interestingly, one of the jurors in the third trial cited Ryan's behavior in court as a major factor in their guilty verdict. The juror observed that Ryan made no reaction when autopsy photos were shown in court, implying that his lack of emotional response influenced the perception of his guilt. Michelle Mockby was murdered on May 29, 2012, at her workplace, Thermo Fisher Scientific in Florence, Kentucky. She was found beaten, bound, and with a plastic bag over her head. David Dooley, a janitor, was initially convicted in 2014 after evidence of falsified time cards and suspicious behavior emerged. His conviction was overturned in 2017 due to withheld evidence, but he was retried and reconvicted in 2019, receiving a 43-year sentence. Michelle Mockby was born in August 1969 in Fort Mitchell, Kentucky. A 16-year employee of Thermo Fisher Scientific, was well-liked and provided a positive presence in the workplace. She worked as a logistics representative and handled payroll. She would process payroll every 2 weeks. Michelle met her husband, Dan Mockby, at Thermo Fisher Scientific. He also worked there. Michelle and Dan had two young daughters, Madeline and Carly. They enjoy spending time with them, as well as their families and friends. On May 29, 2012, at her workplace, Michelle was found beaten to death. She went to work early on Tuesday to get her paycheck on time. About an hour after Michelle arrived at work, the operations manager went to the floor where her office was located. Michelle was still gone. He was surprised because she was supposed to be filling out paperwork, but he chalked it up to tardiness. He decided to return in 20 minutes and went to prepare coffee, but no sooner had he arrived than the janitor, David Dooley, called out to him. He appeared startled and stated that he saw red stains on the carpet outside Michelle's office. David was terrified and said he had no idea where the stains were coming from, because he had been cleaning that morning. The operations manager attempted to open the door, but the office was locked. He decided to find Michelle and see if she needed help. The search wasn't long. He found Michelle lying face down in the corner of her office. She'd been severely beaten, her hands tied behind her back and gagged. She wore a plastic bag over her head. There were numerous blood spatters and a blood trail connecting her office to the location where her body was discovered. Her body was discovered 40 feet from her office, and judging by the blood trail, it appeared that she had been dragged the entire way. Michelle had been brutally murdered. The operations manager immediately dialed 911. According to police, Michelle is not believed to have entered the office that morning. She was killed before she could retrieve her keys. The killer attempted to break into the office. The lock showed signs of forced entry. The autopsy revealed that she had at least 4 blows to the head with a heavy object, a fractured arm, and numerous bruises. The forensic pathologist who performed the autopsy stated that Michelle did not die immediately. She suffered a fractured skull, brain damage, and extensive cuts on her arms and legs. He testified that the pattern of wounds on her head corresponds to the tape dispenser. Michelle, according to the doctor, was struck in the back and collapsed after the first blow. She hit the corner of the wall and sustained a severe liver contusion. Michelle most likely lost consciousness at that point. The killer then grabbed her right arm and attempted to drag her to a less crowded area. And that's when the limb fractured. The police arrived at Mark B's house and took Dan to the station. As a spouse, he was the primary suspect. He had a questionable alibi claiming to be asleep at the alleged time of the murder. However, no one could corroborate his words to rid himself of suspicion. Investigators suggested that Dan take a polygraph test. The test revealed that Dan was probably not involved in the incident. The investigation revealed that there were 13 employees present at the time of the crime. According to the company's manager, the office and warehouse were heavily guarded with only those with a specific pass able to enter. However, because the CCTV footage inside the building was missing, the circle of suspects was reduced and only employees on that floor, supervisors and cleaners, had access to the accounting department. They now had to search the suspects' offices, warehouses, and vehicles. The point is that the perpetrator either changed clothes and hid them somewhere in the car or building, or they fled immediately following the murder and destroyed the evidence. Detectives examined surveillance footage from the parking lot. Only one truck left the lot that morning, around 6:30 a.m., but it returned at 7 a.m., rather suspiciously. The truck belonged to David Dooley. He worked as a janitor for Thermo Fisher. His wife also worked as a janitor. The couple were questioned separately. David was very persuasive. According to his version, he slept through his alarm because he had spent the night caring for his wife who had been poisoned by something and they had spent the majority of the night awake. He had intended to take the night off to care for his wife, but she persuaded him to work the shift and promised to notify him if she felt ill. David arrived at work around 6 a.m. He only had time to clean the warehouse and empty the trash cans in the offices. He then called his wife Janet to see how she was feeling, but she did not pick up. He was afraid she'd passed out. David immediately got into his car and drove home. He returned to work and found the same red stains on the carpet. Detective Bruce McVeigh of the Boone County Sheriff's Office, who was working the case, listened to David's story and was taken aback by the suspect's spotless sneakers. All janitors wore special shoes with detergent stains and scuffed soles. David was dressed neatly that day with clean sneakers. David Dooley's co-workers expressed concerns about his appearance. In addition, he claimed to have emptied the office trash cans. Even so, they were full that morning. Joe Siegert, a warehouse employee, said he saw the suspect not far from Michelle's office and saw David leave work around 1:30 a.m. He appeared scared or depressed. He claimed that the suspect's criminal record for burglary and possession of a firearm in 1996 made the situation even worse. The testimony of Janet, David's spouse, was less detailed. According to her, David left for work that morning and did not return until after lunch. She then recalled her husband arriving home around 6:40 a.m. He had ripped his pants at work, quickly changed his clothes, and returned inside. David was called back in for questioning, but he held his ground. There were no ripped pants. Maybe the spouse was confused about something. She was imagining things due to her condition. David's testimony made Janet doubt her memory. She claimed she had severe hearing problems and hadn't heard David arrive home. She had a high fever that day. However, when she awoke, she discovered dirty, torn pants hanging from the chair. That's why she assumed her husband had arrived to change clothes. Janet's testimony was not the most reliable. She had been inconsistent in the morning due to dehydration and fever. It was suspicious that the couple's testimony did not match, but they had no reason. Michelle was the head of human resources, so she knew many employees' secrets. However, other accounting department employees reported that Janet and Michelle got along well. However, detectives determined that there was still a motive. According to their version, Michelle was supposed to do payroll and paperwork in the morning. David attempted to break into her office early in the morning, knowing Michelle typically arrives by 7 a.m. on Tuesday. However, things did not go as planned. Michelle arrived for work at 5 a.m. and saw David attempting to pick the lock on her office. He couldn't let her go, so he committed the murder. David discovered the very red stains, and he was the only one to leave work that morning. The murder weapon was never found, but he was able to dispose of the evidence. David and his wife Janet worked different shifts, but he forged signatures on timesheets and put in fictitious hours for her, resulting in twice the pay they should have received. The detective assumed Michelle had just caught him forging documents. He intended to place them on her desk, but the plan failed. Investigators knew he was guilty, but there was only circumstantial evidence. David was accused of murder, kidnapping, and tampering with evidence. During the trial, the jury discovered that no murder weapon, bloody clothes, or fingerprints were found. They only had the defendant's strange behavior and appearance. He was required to wear special steel-toed boots while on duty. That morning, however, he returned home wearing new white sneakers and clean clothes. Furthermore, he was the one who discovered the bloodstains and changed his story several times. The jury convicted 45-year-old David Dooley of murder and tampering with physical evidence. The jury deliberated for over 6 hours before convicting David of murder and tampering with evidence. He was sentenced to life in prison plus 5 years for tampering with evidence. At the sentencing hearing, David stated that he had been railroaded. "It is completely unfair how I have been treated. I wasn't given enough time to defend myself properly. I feel cheated as well. I only know that I did not kill Michelle Mockbee. I stand by it and will continue to fight." The guilty verdict was short-lived. A new trial has been ordered. In 2016, just 2 years after David's trial, a law clerk in Boone County Kamney Commonwealth's attorney, Linda Tally Smith's office, downloaded 12 gigabytes of information from the Commonwealth's attorney's office servers onto a thumb drive. Linda was the lead prosecutor in David's case, and the thumb drive was delivered to the Kentucky Attorney General's office. That thumb drive led to the discovery of surveillance footage that had not previously been shared with the defense. Only 10 hours before Michelle was murdered, an unidentified person attempted to enter the building where she worked. Furthermore, the thumb drive revealed additional information. There were allegations that the lead detective in the case, Bruce McVeigh, of the Boone County Sheriff's Office, may have lied during David's trial. He retired, and the internal investigation into the allegations was completed. It was revealed that Bruce and Linda were having an affair, but they claimed it started after the trial ended. A judge ruled that the surveillance video was crucial evidence that had been withheld from the defense. Thus, a new trial was ordered. The prosecution relied on the same evidence as in the first trial. The defense followed a slightly different strategy. At David's second trial, they emphasized that the case against him was purely circumstantial, and that anyone else could have murdered Michelle. They told the jury that they should investigate the possibility that Dan was involved. He was motivated by money. The defense claimed that Dan hired someone to kill Michelle. After Michelle died, Dan received over $700,000 in life insurance and took out $400,000 in cash. The defense questioned him about one specific payment. Dan gave Chris Black a $10,000 check. Chris was Dan's friend. He also worked for Thermo Fisher Scientific. The check was given to him a few months after Michelle died. The defense asked Dan why he gave Chris a $10,000 check and said he couldn't remember. Dan McBee's lawyer argued that he spent all of the money on the kids and the check. He was too devastated to recall some of the details. Warehouse worker Joe Siegert also testified during David Dooley's retrial. Siegert had been with Thermo Fisher Scientific for more than 30 years and knew every employee. According to him, he arrived at work at 4:50 a.m., and there was a lot of business in the warehouse due to the day off. Also, it was the end of the month. Joe Siegert had the warehouse keys and was the one who arrived early every morning to unlock the doors. For a while, he kept to himself and assisted with the unloading of trucks. And at 5:30 a.m., he took the paperwork into the office. Michelle wasn't present yet. He didn't see David Dooley, which was unusual given that David was usually cleaning the warehouse or offices at the time. Joe saw Michelle around 5:53 a.m. She had just arrived for work, grabbed the timesheets from the counter, and entered the office. He was the last person who saw her alive. Joe ran into David Dooley just before 7 a.m. He sat in the back of the warehouse crying and shaking. Then, David excused himself and went home to change his clothes. Joe, the main witness, gave an inaccurate testimony with some timing flaws. Nevertheless, it was admissible. According to Joe, Michelle may have been a pleasant woman in real life after the murder, as it was several years later. However, at work, she and her spouse frequently failed to show employees respect. Joe admitted that many employees disliked the couple. DNA experts from an independent crime lab compared male DNA found on crime scene items to Dan David's DNA. An expert testified that Dan's DNA profile could not be excluded from Michelle's shirt as a significant contributor. David's DNA profile could not be ignored as a minor contributor. He testified that one in every seven Caucasian American men could not be excluded because of their similar characteristics. The defense also told the jury that there was a lot of blood in the office, but none was found in David's truck. The defense argued that there were plenty of other people who had the opportunity and motivation to kill Michelle. They claimed the problem was that they were not thoroughly investigated. Dan Maupi was also in attendance. He was being interviewed as a suspect. Dan was the department manager. He could have given anyone access to the warehouse. Suspicious hatchets were discovered in his car, which he had allegedly purchased at a sale, but he could never explain why he spent all of the money he received from the insurance company. However, for some reason, he was still unable to pay for Michelle's memorial and remained in debt for funeral services. In addition, prior to the incident, the couple owed $70,000. Dan assured that he knew nothing about it and that his wife handled the finances. 2 weeks before the murder, he purchased a computer and installed a program for deleting and encrypting files. At around 9 a.m., investigators discovered Dan running the program. He received a call from Thermo Fisher Scientific employees. His alibi could not be confirmed because the children were spending the night at their parents' house, and it was unknown who attempted to break into the building 10 hours prior to the incident. Finally, defense attorney Deanna Dennison emphasizes to the jury that the standard for judgment is not whether David might have committed the crime, most likely did, or could have done so through a process of elimination. Instead, she emphasized that the key criterion is reasonable doubt, which she believes the prosecution failed to demonstrate. Dennis argued that the presented evidence did not establish a link between David and Michelle's deaths, and thus he should be found not guilty. The prosecution, led by Assistant Attorney General John Heck, countered during the closing arguments. Heck argued that, despite the circumstantial nature of the case, the accumulation of various pieces of evidence forms a compelling case, and he urged the jury to consider all of the evidence when rendering their verdict. Despite the defense's arguments, David was found guilty a second time and sentenced to 38 years in prison. Timothy Wilson Spencer, also known as the Southside Strangler, was a serial killer who committed a series of brutal rapes and murders in Virginia during the 1980s. His crime spree was particularly notable because it led to the first conviction in the United States based on DNA evidence, marking a significant milestone in forensic science and criminal justice. Spencer's crimes left a profound impact on the communities he terrorized and highlighted the importance of DNA evidence in solving violent crimes. Born on July 15, 1952, in Lynchburg, Virginia, Debbie and Dudley Davis had a brief marriage after school that ended in divorce. Then she followed her cousin Judy Fiss to Richmond, Virginia, and moved into an apartment on Devonshire Street in the Westover Hills neighborhood. Debbie started working as Style Weekly's accounts manager in 1985. They are a media outlet based in Richmond. Debbie was a pop culture fan who enjoyed Bruce Springsteen records. She was an extra in the HBO movie, Finnegan Begin Again. Debbie was an avid mystery novel reader. She worked a couple nights a week at the Walden Bookstore at Cloverleaf Mall in Chesterfield County. On the evening of September 18, 1987, Debbie and her coworker Deanna Huff took a road trip to Virginia Beach. They went to see a performance by Dana Carvey. After the show, Deanna dropped Debbie at her apartment and waited to drive off until she was safely inside. Little did Deanna know this would be the last time she ever saw Debbie again. The next morning, a man named Arnold Ellis saw a Renault Alliance parked in front of his house. He noticed the motor was running. The keys were in the ignition, and there was no sign of the car's driver. Arnold Ellis then called the police. Police officers determined that the car belonged to Debbie Davis. She lived one street over from Arnold Ellis. A police officer knocked on Debbie's door, but got no response. An elderly neighbor then came to give the officer a key. Inside, the officer saw Debbie's body face down on her bed. She was topless, wearing only a pair of cut-off jean shorts. Her right arm was tied behind her back with thick bootlaces. Debbie's left arm was tied beneath her. The perpetrator tightly twisted a black sock around her neck. She had been strangled and assaulted. Investigators discovered that the perpetrator stole a rocking chair from a nearby porch and propped it up outside Debbie's kitchen window to gain entrance. Next to Debbie's bed on her nightstand was a mystery novel she had been reading, called Presumed Innocent. It was about a woman who was tied up and then her life was taken. Investigators knew the perpetrator was smart and most likely experienced. He left no fingerprints. There were no witnesses, and nothing had been taken as far as investigators could tell. Detective Ray Williams said, "Very seldom does a crook do that kind of damage and spend that much time with his victim and not leave a bunch of clues." But he left nothing. Lorna Wyckoff, the founder of Style Weekly, posted a $10,000 reward for information leading to an arrest. Investigators looked at people in Debbie's life to see if anyone stood out, but found nothing. Debbie led a quiet life. Debbie was not dating anyone, she had not seen her ex-husband in years, and she did not use drugs and did not hang out in bars. Just 2 weeks after Debbie's life was ended, tragedy would strike again in Richmond, Virginia. Susan Elizabeth Hellams was born on February 6, 1955 in Charleston, South Carolina. She moved to Richmond, Virginia, to work on a residency in neurosurgery at the Medical College of Virginia. Susan married Marcel Slag and bought a house in the tranquil Woodland Heights neighborhood in Richmond. On October 3, 1987, Marcel pulled up to their house at 1:45 a.m. As he entered the house, he could hear her moving around upstairs. Marcel knew she had worked late and thought he might have woken her up. He quickly took a shower and silently crept into their dark bedroom. As his eyes adjusted to the darkness, he could make out a sight from a horror movie. His wife's partially nude body laying half out of their bedroom closet. A red leather belt was around her neck. Susan's hands had been bound tightly behind her back with an extension cord and necktie. Just like Debbie, Susan had been assaulted and strangled. Marcel saw their bedroom window was wide open. Their house was a little less than a mile away from Debbie Davis's house. Detective Ray Williams was on duty that night and was ordered to work both cases. Williams said that the perpetrator was still in the house when Marcel arrived home. He heard somebody upstairs. It couldn't have been Susan. She was already gone. On the balcony outside the window, investigators found an open Vaseline jar left by the perpetrator. They traced its purchase to a store adjacent to nearby Cloverleaf Mall. The lead was followed but led to nowhere. Realizing a serial offender is in their midst, the community erupted into fear. They demanded action from the police. Williams worked tirelessly for days and finally, he did find a clue that could potentially be useful. When he looked through the financial records at the Cloverleaf Mall Walden Bookstore, where Debbie worked part-time, he found a check written by Susan and endorsed on the back by Debbie. Williams wasn't sure if this was just a coincidence, or if it was a possible link between the two crimes. As Detective Williams pondered this question, yet another horrendous crime took place in the Richmond area. Diane Cho was born in Korea in 1972. She and her family immigrated to the United States in 1984. On 1987, 15-year-old Diane was a freshman at Manchester High School. She was very smart and took care of virtually everything for her parents, who barely spoke English. In October of 1987, Diane told one of her friends about a disturbing, recurring nightmare she had been having. Diane kept having dreams about an unknown man following her. She also told her friends at school that she sometimes saw this unknown man from her dreams at the mall. One night in November of 1987, Diane went to the Cloverleaf Mall Theater with a friend. They bought tickets for The Princess Bride. She then began trembling with fright and pointed out her stalker, who was staring at them from the parking lot. It had been barely 5 months since Diane's family moved to Richmond, where her parents worked long hours running a convenience store near Virginia Commonwealth University. It's not known if Diane ever told her parents about the encounter with the unknown man at the Cloverleaf Mall. On the night of November 21st of 1987, Diane's parents arrived home to their apartment around 9. Diane's mother then gave her a haircut. As they went to bed around midnight, they could hear Diane typing out an English paper in her bedroom across the hall. The next day, Diane's parents called home around 2 p.m. to remind their children to get ready for an afternoon church service. Diane's 12-year-old brother, Roman, answered the phone. Diane was still asleep and he did not want to anger her by waking her up. Diane's parents arrived home about an hour later and her mother went straight to Diane's bedroom and opened the door. Diane's mom then screamed loudly. Diane was tied up with rope, she had been strangled and assaulted, and her bedroom window was open. You can clearly see the pattern of all the crimes. It would happen again for the fourth time. Forty-four-year-old Sue Tucker lived in Arlington County, Virginia in November of 1987. She was an editor for a Department of Agriculture magazine. Her husband, Reg Tucker, was a former photographer for the Fairfax County Public Schools. Reg had taken a job as a photography teacher in his native country of Wales in early 1987. Sue was preparing the couple's home for sale and winding down her projects at work as she planned to join her husband in Wales. Ironically, they wanted to immigrate because of an increase in violence in the United States. They were worried about crime. A neighbor of the couple, Audrey Cieslove, had been unable to reach Sue for a few days and noticed that Sue's bedroom window had been open for days. When Audrey tried to enter their home to check on her friend, she smelled an odor like rotting flesh. She called the police, who arrived and found Sue's badly decomposing body laid out across her bed. She had been tightly bound in nylon ropes, strangled, and assaulted. There were no fingerprints. The perpetrator had broken in through a small basement laundry room window. Before leaving, he had taken the time to fix a snack. He discarded a partially eaten orange on the Tucker's dining room table. While investigators were inside the house, the telephone rang. It was Reg Tucker. The last few days he had been trying to reach Sue. Police officers had to give him the horrible news. Arlington investigators who were assigned to the case realized the crime was very similar to the one that took place in January of 1984. 32-year-old attorney Carolyn Hamm was slain. Her body had been found not far from Sue Tucker's home. David Vasquez, a fast food worker with a low IQ, had confessed to that crime and was serving a 35-year prison sentence for it. If he was in prison, why were there identical crimes being committed almost 4 years later? Arlington County Detective Joe Horgies was the lead investigator on Sue Tucker's case. He traveled to the prison to interview David Vasquez because the modus operandi was the same. The hands tied behind the back, rope around the neck, and they were both assaulted. After the interview, it was clear to the detective that Vasquez was not at all involved with what happened to Sue. As investigators in both Arlington County and Richmond investigated their cases, they noticed something. Just like Richmond had a serial offender attacking women in their homes in 1987, Arlington County had their own maniac in 1983 and 1984. It all started in Arlington in June of 1983 with the abduction and assault of a woman in the county's Green Valley area by a knife-wielding black man in his late teens or early 20s wearing a homemade mask. Over the next 7 months, as his attacks escalated, he abducted women in their cars and entered their houses and apartments through unlocked windows. He relentlessly assaulted and brutalized 9 women. He tied some of them up with nylon cords cut from their Venetian blinds. Former Arlington County Commonwealth's attorney, Halen Fahey, was quoted as saying, he was a one-person crime wave. In January of 1984, an Arlington woman came home to discover evidence from an unsettling break-in. The cords of her Venetian blinds had been cut and were laid out on her bed. The intruder left the house. It seemed like he was there waiting for her to come home and got tired of waiting. It was 4 days after that Caroline Hamm was found bound and strangled in her garage. Arlington police arrested David Vasquez and charged him with taking her life. Vasquez did not match the description that any of the assault victims gave, but the crimes in the area did stop. It was only after Sue Tucker's slaying that investigators learned the perpetrator of all the assaults was definitely not Vasquez, and the unknown man took a brief hiatus and then continued his attacks in Richmond. Detective Hodges received a teletype from Richmond police where they described the identical strangulations of Debbie Davis, Susan Helms, and Diane Cho. After sharing all the information, investigators concluded it was the same man responsible for all the crimes, perhaps even Caroline Ham's slaying. The investigation stalled for another few agonizing weeks while they hoped for a break in the case before the strangler could take another life. Investigators looked at the timeline of the crimes. Many of them took place in 1983 to 1984, and then continued in 1987. The FBI felt that the perpetrator would not have stopped his attacks of his own volition. It was likely that he had been jailed for another offense between the slayings of Caroline Ham and Debbie Davis. As detectives tried to think about possible suspects, one of them thought of Tommy Spencer. He was a teenager that was arrested for burglary during the mid-1970s. Investigators discovered that Spencer had been arrested in January of 1984 for break-ins in neighboring Alexandria. He had been paroled to a halfway house in Richmond in 1987, right before Debbie's life was taken. Investigators went to the halfway house. They found that Spencer signed himself out on every evening a crime took place. He got a furlough to go to Arlington on the day that Sue Tucker's life was taken. Investigators decided to put Spencer under surveillance. They wanted to catch him in the act of doing something incriminating. Over 2 weeks, plainclothes Richmond police officers observed Spencer committing parole violations like spending the night at his girlfriend's house. They were intrigued to find that he would hang out for hours at Cloverleaf Mall. As you remember, the mall had strong ties to Debbie Davis, Susan Helms, and Diane Cho. On January 20th of 1988, Arlington and Richmond detectives took Spencer into custody and took a sample of his blood. Without witnesses or fingerprints, or any other direct evidence tying Spencer to the crimes, law enforcement had to rely on a brand new forensic science method called DNA fingerprinting. At that stage, it has only been used in one cold case in the United Kingdom and never before in the United States. It was the case of Linda Mann and Don Ashworth. It would take more than 6 weeks, but a private lab in New York would report back that Spencer's DNA had been matched to male DNA at the crime scenes of Debbie Davis, Dr. Susan Helms, Susan Tucker, and assault victims in Arlington and Richmond. Timothy Spencer was the man who had become known as the Southside Strangler. He went to trial in July of 1988. After a 6-day trial, he was found guilty. It was the first conviction based on DNA evidence in the United States. Spencer was given multiple life sentences. After DNA linked Timothy Spencer to all the other crimes, investigators were seriously doubting that David Vasquez was involved. DNA soon proved it as well, and Vasquez was released. David Vasquez became known as the first person in the United States that was exonerated thanks to DNA. Shortly before 11 p.m. on Wednesday, April 27th of 1994, Timothy Wilson Spencer was strapped into Virginia's sturdy oaken electric chair dubbed Old Sparky at Greensville Correctional Center, and was executed, finally bringing a stop to the horrendous crime spree. In December 1988, in a rural wooded area in Waycross, Georgia, a truck driver discovered skeletal remains in a box off Duncan Bridge Road. It could have been down over in here, behind these trees here. The remains were that of a young child and were found concealed inside a duffel bag that was placed inside a suitcase, and further concealed inside an old television cabinet. Investigators estimated that the young child had lost her life about 1 to 2 months before being found. The child was a black female and thought to be 3 to 4 years old. She had black hair pulled into a ponytail secured on the top of her head by a brown rubber band. She was found wearing a white knit pullover shirt with a red pony emblem on the upper left chest, white thermal pajama bottoms with maroon trim, and a disposable diaper. The Jane Doe's ears were pierced, but no earrings could be found with her remains. Where county sheriff investigators responded to the scene and began working to identify the young girl. Local investigators teamed with the Georgia Bureau of Investigation to aid the investigation. Hundreds of leads and tips to identify the child were examined, and substantial investigative effort was applied toward the case.
This case just happens to be the one that finally, after all these years, it came down to one person making a call that put the puzzle together for us.
Unfortunately, with few solid leads to pursue, the case soon went cold. Then in 2009, authorities reached out to the National Center for Missing and Exploited Children for assistance. Over the years, the center, along with its long-standing partners, conducted several analytical searches and DNA testing in an attempt to locate potential matches to missing children. In 2012, the center's Team Adam was deployed to Georgia and met with investigators for a case review. Team Adam provided technical assistance to the GBI, coordinating efforts to get a new facial reconstruction completed. They completed a facial reconstruction of the little girl using a CT scan of the child's skull and digitally recreated images of the pajamas the child was found wearing. These images were used to create a poster and feature the case on Help ID Me, their Facebook page dedicated to sharing information about unidentified children. In 2020, Texas scientists developed a suitable DNA extract from the evidence submitted by Georgia Bureau of Investigation, and then used forensic-grade genome sequencing to build a comprehensive DNA profile for the unknown girl. After successfully completing the profile, the DNA profile was delivered to the Georgia Bureau of Investigation. Investigators worked with a team of forensic genetic genealogists to develop leads in the case. Their effort, in conjunction with additional leads and tips that surfaced from the increased visibility of the case, led to a potential identity for the young girl.
This case just happens to be the one that finally, after all these years, it came down to one person making a call that put the puzzle together for us.
In January of 2023, the GBI said they received a tip from a member of the public claiming to have seen the National Center for Missing and Exploited Children's facial reconstruction. The tipster told police they believed the young girl was Kenyatta Odom. An extensive investigation was then launched to see if that was the case. DNA testing of a genetic relative then confirmed the positive identification of Waycross Jane Doe as 5-year-old Kenyatta Odom. On November 10, 2023, investigators arrested Kenyatta's mother, Evelyn Odom, age 56, and her former boyfriend, Ulister Sanders, age 61, both of Albany, Georgia. They were indicted and charged with taking a life, cruelty to children in the first degree, aggravated battery, family violence, and concealing a body. Angeline Hartman, the director of communications at the National Center for Missing and Exploited Children, said, "This is a case that has touched so many of us at the National Center for Missing and Exploited Children. The heinous details are almost too much to bear, and we have always hoped for answers. We know that navigating these challenging cases is no easy feat. Countless investigators worked relentlessly over the last 35 years. And we are honored to support all the agencies involved who helped solve this case." Colin McNally, a forensic imaging supervisor, is the artist who created Kenyatta's image that led to her identification. Angeline Hartman added, "It is an overwhelming feeling when one of our images assists in the identification of a child," said McNally. "These images are designed to capture the attention of an individual who may recognize the person. And they have proven instrumental in solving cases." The National Center for Missing and Exploited Children is currently assisting law enforcement with more than 650 cases of unidentified remains of children. GBI Special Agent in Charge Jason Sechrist had this to say, "To think that a parent actually tossed this child, basically, into an illegal trash site off the side of the road. It is heartbreaking to consider what that child lived through. People do not get to that point generally just in one moment. To think of the life that child had to live through even up to that point, and then to just be thrown away." Sechrist said the technology landscape has changed so drastically that he is certain more cases like Kenyatta's will be solved. But many, like Kenyatta's case, need that last crucial piece. Working an investigation and bringing it to a conclusion is not magic. It does take the knowledge and dedication of the agents and investigators that work it. But sometimes we need a tip. Sechrist said, "We need that right piece of information that pushes us over the finish line. So if you think you have that information, please call the tip line on any case."
And that her mother said that the child had gone to live with her father. This person never really believed that story and found that it may not, just didn't believe it was true. Both Evelyn and Ulister were arrested without incident on Thursday, November 9th, 2023.
Elena Estela Mina's life was tragically cut short on October 27, 1979, during a horrifying attack at her workplace in Sunnyvale, California. As an 18-year-old security guard at the Western Electric offices, Estela endured a terrifying ordeal when a knife-wielding assailant attempted to assault her. The ensuing struggle resulted in multiple stab wounds, and despite a colleague's heroic intervention, Estela succumbed to her injuries. For over four decades, Estela's senseless slaying remained a heart-wrenching, unsolved mystery. However, recent advancements in DNA technology and forensic genealogy have unveiled the identity of her assailant, shedding light on the circumstances surrounding her demise and the fate of the assailant. The brutal slaying of Estela Mina had long haunted Sunnyvale as an unresolved case. Multiple generations of detectives had diligently pursued leads, scrutinized evidence, and interviewed potential suspects, yet the perpetrator had eluded justice. The mystery persisted for decades, leaving the victim's family and the community in perpetual distress. In the long pursuit of justice for Estela Mina, investigators faced numerous challenges when collecting and analyzing the evidence from the 1979 crime scene. Crime scene investigators diligently collected approximately 30 items, yet their initial efforts yielded just two sources of DNA, that of the victim and an unidentified male traced from blood found at the scene. The DNA profiles derived from these samples were entered into the FBI's combined DNA index system in 2011, but the quest for a match proved futile. The investigation extended to the collection of various hair samples, which were forwarded to the California Department of Justice in 2015 for analysis. Dishearteningly, these efforts also failed to produce any conclusive identifications. The challenge of obtaining viable DNA profiles from the evidence tested in 2011 was explained by Deputy District Attorney Robert Baker, who noted that the analysis of mixtures and degraded samples was notably more formidable back then, compared to modern-day advancements in forensic science and technology. In 2023, in a remarkable breakthrough that brought hope to this cold case, Sunnyvale Detective Matt Hutchison took a significant step in the investigation by submitting blood samples extracted from Estela's clothing and shoes to the Santa Clara County Crime Lab. Lab technicians successfully extracted a male DNA profile from these samples, marking a pivotal turning point in the investigation. The suspense in Estela Mina's case finally came to an end when Sunnyvale police confirmed that the DNA profile had led to a conclusive match. The profile belonged to Sam Silver, a violent offender who was just 18 years old at the time of the attack on Estela Mina. During her valiant struggle to survive, Estela had managed to draw Silver's blood, leaving behind an incriminating trace that would ultimately expose her assailant 44 years after the crime. Sam Silver, the man identified as Estela Mina's assailant, had a dark and disturbing past. At the time of the attack, he was merely 18 years old, but his criminal history was already marred by charges of manslaughter, attempting to take a life, assault with a lethal weapon, assault and firearms offenses. He had a frightening propensity for violence and lawlessness. Silver's connection to the area at the time of the attack is noteworthy, as he was staying with family members in the county, and it is very likely that he had previously crossed paths with Estela when they both worked at Great America. However, after committing the heinous act, he fled back to Colorado, where he continued to engage in criminal activities. Sam Silver passed away in 2008, while incarcerated in a Colorado prison, serving a sentence related to a gun charge. The unfortunate turn of events meant that he would never face the consequences of the heinous crime he had committed against Estela Mina in 1979, leaving her family and the community without the closure they had long sought. Elena Estela Mina's case is a testament to the power of modern DNA technology and forensic genealogy in solving cold cases that have long defied resolution. Her tragic end, which remained unsolved for over four decades, was finally resolved with the identification of her assailant. While Estela Mina's life was unjustly cut short, her memory can now be honored with the knowledge that her perpetrator has been identified, even if he escaped justice during his lifetime.